Tom now has a special signal. It's called the Lee sign. He goes like this. Push the button. I'm trying to save batteries. They're so expensive. Good morning, everybody. How are you today? Anybody here last night for our conference? A couple people? Oh, man, what a great night we had. It was wonderful. God did some really cool things with Darryl Strawberry's message and the workshops that we had from the addiction recovery facilities in this area. Just be praying for the continued impact of that ministry last night as we try to reach our community with the message of the gospel, especially for those that are in bondage to addiction. It was just a really powerful night. So we're going to start with a song here this morning, Like a River Glorious. It's not the one flowing through the parking lot right now. So this is, you know, the river of peace that God wants to flow through our souls when we trust him. So we're going to get started getting our hearts in tune with the Lord this morning. So sing right along here as we sing about his peace together today. Says it passes all understanding. If you've ever experienced it, you know what that really means. We go through things in life. We probably all have a testimony of something going on in life, and you look at it from, you know, kind of an outside perspective and say, I don't know how I even walked through that without falling apart. And then you realize that that's what God's promise is, peace beyond our understanding, that he comes in when we need it most, when we don't have the strength in ourselves, and we can trust him to take care of us and say, like this favorite hymn, it is well with my soul because I know that God's the one taking care of it. Let's sing this together.
When peace like a river ascendeth my way, when sun to say
To a good start with that, praising your Savior all the day long. I hope that sticks with you through the day. Thanks so much for coming out to worship and hear the Word of God. Jeff and Carolyn have some music for us to enjoy here and to tune our hearts for worship, and then we'll sing another song together in just a minute.
Thank you.
Ever had a big problem? No, only me. Wow. Can y'all teach me something? You ever heard this? Don't tell God how big your problems are. Tell your problems how big your God is. We serve a great and powerful God who created this whole universe, and if he can control and sustain all of his creation, he can certainly intervene in our lives and handle what we see as the biggest problems. You're going to hear a testimony this morning from a walking miracle of God's greatness and transformative power. And so we want to praise our God this morning for that power, for all that he has made, for all that he sustains, and for all that he wants to do with that same power in our lives today, right here, right now. So if you're able to stand, why don't you stand? Let's sing this powerful song of God's greatness, How Great Thou Art. Let's lift him up this morning. Serve a great God today. Thank you so much for worshiping him in song here. You can be seated. Pastor Jay, come and give us greeting.
Welcome to worship with us at Ocean City Tabernacle and online with us today. Thanks so much for being here. It's an exciting day. We just came to the closure of 4 weeks of Vacation Bible School. I had over 100 kids here the different mornings this week, and it was a beautiful thing. We're going to show you a video of that during the operatory today, and you'll see a lot of these kids getting ministered to and enjoying their week. Also, we have these Bibles in the racks in front of you for the message this morning. Just want to point that out to you. And then we also have contact cards in there. And you can provide us with your email and mailing address so that we can inform you of new things. We'll inform you of the schedule when it comes out for next year. But also, as things come up in the coming weeks, we have a marriage seminar. We have a women's conference coming up. So you can either go online or fill out one of these cards, put it in the offering plate for that, please. And then also in there are these offering envelopes. If you didn't come prepared to give an offering, you could go online and do it. What you see on the screen there. Or you could take one of these offering envelopes and mail in a check if that's your preference, if God so leads you. We want you to prayerfully consider that. And one thing to consider this week in prayer is just helping us with the Vacation Bible School expenses. And then also last night we had a really special event here, really important event, where families from the community came out to talk about overcoming addiction. So we had, 150 or 200 people here. We had a handful of workshops with America's Keswick and Honey Lake Clinic, addiction, depression clinic involved. And obviously, Darryl Strawberry spoke at it, and it was a special time. These families were ministered to and encouraged in the struggles that they're facing. And I thought about it, I thought even the vulnerability of coming out here and saying, we have this problem in my family, took a lot for them. But I also think it was probably comforting for them to come out and see a community of people going through this and at least realize they're not in it alone, to hear from Darryl about how Jesus is the only answer to help them walk through that as well. Also, I want to share with you something I find really neat. When I hear about people that have come here for generations, how many of you came, your parents came here as well? Yeah, I love that. I love that. Grandparents also? Anybody? Yeah, I love that. I love that. And so our leader of Vacation Bible School for the last 3 years, who's led it for 20 years in different churches, she's been here about the last 3 years, is Amy Tolson Holmes. Her parents are Mike and Mitzi Tolson. Her grandparents, Herb and Kathy Adams. Herb used to be a trustee and a greeter, usher here at that door over there when we used to use that. That was Herb's door. And so, Amy came up through her Christian heritage with the Tabernacle as a foundation to that. And now she is, these years later, leading our Vacation Bible School of more than 100 kids a week. So I love how beautiful that is, and really appreciate Amy. Really appreciate all you that have been here for generations, and God working in your families. And just, I value, as much as anything, I value him using the Tabernacle in lives of families. That's part of why we believe God has us here to exist, to help families to strengthen and to help people to worship God and to help people to know God through the Bible. So again, thank you for being here. In these brochures, you'll see our upcoming concerts. We have Paul Beloche tonight at 7 p.m. with a hymn sing at 6:30. And then next Sunday, we have Sheila Walsh speaking in the morning. Now, Sheila used to do a lot of the Women of Faith conferences, speaking at those, and also now she's a host with on the David Jeremiah radio show, speaks there, and then she still does concerts. She was best known for being a worship musician and very popular Christian worship singer. And so she'll be here for both Sunday morning, she'll be speaking, and then Sunday evening she'll be singing. So we look very forward to her being here next week as well. During the week, you'll also find in here we have different Bible study groups for men and women and combination thereof. And then we also are going to have an upcoming marriage seminar August 28th with Pastor Al and his wife Lisa Robertson. Al is the pastor from the Duck Dynasty show, and they go around and do marriage seminars like this, and he's going to be speaking here that next Sunday morning as well, August 29th. We're excited about that. But for today, we're so blessed to have one of my favorite speakers from two summers ago. He got up here, Darryl Strawberry. You know that already. That's probably part of why you're here. And I loved it when he pointed to the cross and he said, I hope you didn't come to hear about baseball, because I'm not here about baseball. I'm here about Jesus Christ. And he gave one of the best messages that summer from start to finish about Jesus Christ. He's going to be in the lobby afterwards for a meet and greet. And so you're welcome to go out there, shake his hand, and get his selfie. As I've been taking him around through Ocean City to restaurants, everybody's wanting his photo. And yeah, it's kind of funny just being like his tour guide. So that's all right. It's a good thing. And he's given, you know, sharing with everybody about Jesus. So also today we're going to be able to be back there. You'll be able to get a copy of his message back at the bookstore if you want. Or it's on our website also. After these services, we have the messages of all the speakers this summer. So we're going to take the offering now. I'm going to ask the ushers to come up, and I'm going to pray for our message and for you and your families too. So let's pray. Lord God, we love you. We're here today to worship you, to know you better, Lord, through your word, through the testimony of your work and the life of your servant, Darryl Strawberry. Father, strengthen our families through this message as well. Give us strength to overcome sin areas of our life, such as the addictions he's been through. Lord, bless each family represented here. Help each family to grow in their walk with you, Lord, to know you better. Help the parents to have wisdom in parenting. Help each married couple to have wisdom and be able to apply your word in their marriages, that they'd be stronger. We love you, Lord. We give you this time. We give you the stewardship of these funds for your glory, for your mission here at Ocean City Tabernacle. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Construction has begun. Rivets and ratchets. Thank you so much, Pastor Jay, and thank you to your lovely wife. And that's probably one of the most incredible videos I've got a chance to see, you know, because really the most important thing, it has to do with kids. And that should be our main focus in this nation. It should be our younger people. All the rest of us, you know, we got issues. But our young people really need us, and they really need to know the importance of who they are, not what we do, but who we are in Christ. And I think as a nation, we have gotten away from really what's important is our young people and investing in our young people. So it's good to see, you know, a ministry like this, you know, take time out to make it important for our young people to come to a place to know who Jesus Christ is. And that's the most important thing today, is knowing who Jesus Christ is. Amen? Amen. We're going to have a little fun this morning. Glory to God. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We honor you, praise you. Father, we give you glory. Father, we thank you for this day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us be glad, Father, because you have not forgotten about us. You woke us up this morning. You gave us another day. You gave us another opportunity. You gave us another opportunity to serve you and honor you and glorify you and magnify your name and tell someone else about the goodness of who you are. Father, you created something good with us, but in the society that we live in now, we know is very dark, Father. But it's your grace and mercy that gives us strength to move forward. Let us create every opportunity for good. Let us speak life. Let us speak the word of God. May it change his life forever. Father, we send this petition up to you, and we ask that you seal it over us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, amen. Well, it's good to be back here. I was here before. In 2019, we had a wonderful time. So guess what? I plan on having another wonderful time. Anywhere I go to speak for God, I have a wonderful time, because it has nothing to do with me. It has to do with him and his kingdom and what he does. Because he's a great God, he's a loving God, he's a merciful God, he's a forgiving God, and he's a right-on-time God. And I think as a nation, we have gotten away from that. You know, like I said before, in my life, you know, I wasn't always like this. I wasn't, you know, this person, and, you know, I played sports and played baseball, and, you know, I had this lifestyle of fame and fortune, rich, privileged, lived behind community gates, and thought I had it all together, but I was ended up being a heathen, a liar, womanizer, alcoholic, drug addict, sinner, saved by grace. It's only the grace of God that can save a man. A man can't save himself. It's only God's grace that can save you. And if you don't ever come to that place of understanding who Jesus is, you will miss out on who you are as a man. Because he created us for good. From the beginning, it was Adam, and then Eve came along. And there it was. One man brought sin in, but then he created his son, Jesus. One man brought grace in for all. So Jesus already paid the price for all of us, for whatever mistakes we make and whoever we are and whatever happens in our life. Jesus already paid the price for it. All we got to do is trust the process. Sometimes that's a little hard to trust, right? Because my message today is clear about when things happen. It's called when things happen. Things will happen. What kind of things? Pandemic, financial problems, sickness, marital problems, kids' problems, job loss, real life. What are we doing? Are we operating in faith or fear? A society has tried to cripple us and make us operate in fear. But see, I'm a believer, and I know the Bible, so I don't operate in fear. I operate in faith. What is faith? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You see, it's the things not seen. When you know who you are in Christ, you don't worry about what a society is saying, what the news is saying, what everybody is projecting, because it all is meaningless at the end of the day, because they don't have the last say. God has the last say. Have we gotten away from God having the last say over our lives, over our families, over our kids? See, my mother predicted this for me. She predicted that I would to be doing God's will one day. And she told me when she was dying at the age of 55, I was laying on the bed with her, and she asked me to pray, and I was lost. I was famous and rich, and I was lost. She wasn't concerned about my baseball career. She was concerned it was all going to be well in my soul. She wasn't concerned about me being rich. She was concerned about me having salvation. And she said, God spoke to her, and she said, God said he's going to get it out of you. She said, you're going to go through it, but he's going to get it out of you. God's called you. I was like, oh, my God. See, when mama tells you something, you listen. Even though you don't want to hear it, but you do listen to it. And she was right. God had a plan for me. It was far greater than baseball. Baseball was just a platform. My troubles was just a platform to get to this place where God had for me. I didn't realize that God would find me in a pit and put me in a pulpit. And I'm not even qualified. You don't have to be qualified. He's not looking for qualified people. He's looking for people who are available, who is willing to say yes, who is willing to get rid of their own egos and their own personalities and their own IQs about who they are and say yes to him. Because when you come into a relationship with Christ, he has the perfect plan already mapped out for you. Even when things happen, like I just said here, when things happen, who are we trusting? When things happen, who the things that we experienced in this country over the last 18 months or whatever it's been, you know, it's been crazy, it's been chaotic, and who are we trusting? Who are we leaning on? Who is our answer? And is the answer will always be the same. It will never change. It is the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's already done it. See, are we like the scribes and the Pharisees that we don't know him? Like when he was hanging on the cross, the scribes and the Pharisees didn't know who he was. We are like the same people in this generation, like the scribes and the Pharisees don't know who he is. He was hanging on the cross, and he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Then he said, Father, why have you forsaken me? And his last words on the cross was incredible. It is finished. Everything that can kill us, Jesus already killed it. He's already done it on the cross. Because he went to the tomb, and early Sunday morning, he got up from the tomb, and he got up with all power. He was resurrected. So when we die from this fleshly body, we get to be resurrected just like Christ. Galatians 2:20 talks about it. It says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live. It is Christ who lives in me. See, Christ rules and reigns over your life when he's Lord over your life. But if he's not Lord over your life, he cannot rule and reign over your life because you haven't invited him in to be Lord over your life. Even when things happen, in the society that we look at today, things are happening. People are struggling financially. Sickness, COVID is killing people left to right. But that doesn't mean we walk in fear. We walk in faith. Like I told the group last night, I win either way. If I stay here, I win. If I don't, I win. If I leave here, I don't have any more sickness. I don't have to deal with being a diabetic anymore. I don't have to deal with none of it if I leave here. I don't have to take medicine no more. I'm free if I leave here. See, because when absence from the body is presence with the Lord, you go on to be with the Lord forever. You get to live forever with God if you believe what the Word is saying. Not if you believe what man is saying. I'm just a man. I'm just a vessel. I'm a spirit that God has that God dwells in, and he brings us to the place to be able to do his great work and share the good news so somebody else can receive Christ and be born again and be set free. See, we have gotten away from really preaching the gospel like Billy Graham. See, Billy Graham preached the gospel about repentance and turning from the wicked ways. But we haven't turned from the wicked ways. We're consumed with all these wicked things and believe in all these other things, and we believe in all the political people instead of believing what the Bible is telling us. See, the Bible has been here forever, and it will always be here forever. Even when you go and when I go, this book will still be here. Heaven and earth will pass away, but not my word. The Word of God will not pass away. It will be here, and God will pour his Spirit down in somebody, and they will end up preaching the gospel just like I am today. Not qualified, never been to school, but God called me to preach the gospel. Because that's what God does. When you remember Saul, he was on Damascus Road, and God knocked him off and blinded him for 3 days and three nights. And he was a Christian killer. And he had an encounter with Christ, our Lord Jesus, on the road. And there it was, God would bring about a transformation in his life. And then he would become the Apostle Paul to go on to write 13 epistles. You know what epistles are? Those are letters. He goes on to write letters about the gospel of Jesus Christ because the Lord transformed his life. So when things happen, who are we trusting? When you're experiencing fear and doubts, who are we trusting? Like I said before, I wasn't always like this. I was always hitting home runs, winning championships, and slapping high five, and buying more stuff, and thought it was going to make me well, and none of it never made me well. See, what made me well is coming to have a personal relationship with Christ and surrendering my life so I can live an abundant life that he talks about when things do happen, because they happen to all of us. Who are you trusting when things happen? See, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. It says, lean not on your own understanding. It says, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. See, he already got a plan mapped out for you. All you got to do is come to the place of trusting in the Lord. Are you trusting in the Lord? Are you trusting in what somebody else is saying? Are you trusting in how much you got in the bank, or are you trusting in all these things? Because I realized one thing when God called me. He told me, the money don't belong to you, the house don't belong to you, the car don't belong to you, the job don't belong to you. He says, I'm just loaning it to you. It's pretty cool when you understand that none of this belongs to me, and God is just loaning it to us to do his great will here, that we would build the kingdom and we would help transform lives. Have we gotten away from that as a nation of people? Why do you think the darkness have fallen up on this nation? See, because one thing I do know, and I told them last night, I'm telling you today, this is not about a black and white thing. This is about sin. This is about sin. Sin has crippled this nation from God. This nation has turned their back on God. And guess what? The great punishment on this nation is because of sin. That's where we're at. The reality is most people don't want to say it. They want to say, well, this is the issue. This is the issue. No, he said, for the wages of sin is death. The gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The gift is of God. It's eternal life in Christ Jesus. Not life, eternal life. You get to live a totally different life. See, I get to live a totally different life than I live when I play sports. See, they were talking about me when I were playing sports. Now they're talking about me today because I love Jesus. Just get over it, because they're going to talk about you anyway. That's the reality that we live in. We live in a reality where you turn on the television. I don't even watch the television, the news and stuff, because it's all fake. You know, they brought total hatred towards each other. They brought hatred towards people. They made people hate people. And you know what God loves more than anything? God loves people. He don't care how broken you are. He don't care how confused you are. He loves people. He always has. When you go through the Bible and you understand the Bible, when things happened, when they all had issues, Moses, speech impediment, God used him mightily to lead the Israelites out of bondage, 400 years of slavery. Moses couldn't even speak. David put his best man Uriah on the front line to get killed so he could have his wife Bathsheba. God used him, said, David is a man after my own heart. Peter denied Christ 3 times. He asked to be crucified upside down, because he didn't feel worthy. Jonah, God told him to go to Nineveh to preach the gospel. He jumps on a boat to go the other way to Tarshish. God throws him in the belly of a fish for 3 days and 3 nights, then spit him out. Then Jonah goes there and tell them, the whole city, because they were acting like a bunch of pagans. They were Gentiles like all of us. Jonah was a Jewish. And God sends him there to tell the city to repent. And Jonah tells the city, repent, and the whole city gets saved by one man. Jonah was mad at God and sat under a tree, mad at God. And God said, Jonah, from now on, my grace will be for all. See, God has given us grace and extended his grace for all of us. But it's a matter of, do I think I'm better than the next person? See, none of us are, because when you go through this Bible, they all had issues just like all the rest of us. And they come to a place with God where God would use them mightily because of their obedience. That's the only reason why God is using me, because I obeyed him. Had I not come to the place of surrender and obeying, he couldn't use me. I couldn't be in the pulpit to be able to preach the gospel, because I wouldn't be able to have the revelation of the gospel, because the gospel does not come from here, it comes from the kingdom of God. If do we understand the kingdom? Matthew 6:33 talks about it. It says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then all these things will be added into you. See, God's got more things than stuff. See, we think it's stuff. You know, and I remember what Jesus is talking about in John 10:10, where he talks about the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and I have come that they may have life and may have it more abundantly. See, he's talking about an abundant life was far greater than anything that we can ever imagine. Abundant life. Jesus is talking about joy, peace, wisdom, knowledge, power is far greater than any stuff you will ever achieve from this earthly standpoint, because what comes out of Jesus is great. No other man has that. Why? Because Jesus is a man with no sin in him. That is a holy, righteous man that hung on the cross of Calvary, a sinless man that comes in his blood. When it comes into you, it purifies you, liberates you, redeems you, brings you to wholeness and righteousness and right standards with God. A nation has become crippled because we are not in right standards with God. We're looking for answers, and the answers are in this book. They always have been in this book. They always will be in this book. Man doesn't have the answers, because man didn't create this. God created every last one of us. So when things do happen, who do we trust? Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. It tells us to lean not on our own understanding. It tells us in all our ways acknowledge him. Not some of our ways, but he says all our ways acknowledge him. And if we acknowledge him, we'll understand how to get through the storms of life. Do you know there's real storms in life? Either you're in a storm, or storm's on the way, or you're coming out of a storm. And it just goes in a circle. The storms of life. The storms of life are real. Either you're in a storm or coming out of a storm, or a storm's on the way. But I do know one thing with God. And he showed me when I was in the wilderness. See, there's something great about being in the wilderness when God sits you and puts you in the wilderness, just like he did me. He sat me for like 7 years and put me in the wilderness, made me sit in the back of the church and get discipled, put me in the wilderness, didn't allow anything to happen in my life. He wasn't concerned about what he could get to me. He was concerned, could he get me well? See, God is never concerned about what he can get to us. He's concerned, can I get you well? Can I get you well? Can I get you well enough to do my will, that you would do great kingdom work and you would lead people back to the cross and tell them about the love of my wonderful son that I created for everybody. I didn't just create it for some people. I created it for everybody. Everybody. It's free. It's free. This book is free. Why are we so stubborn and we don't pick it up and don't believe it? And it's free. But we'll go pay for everything else. We'll go pay for a doctor opinion. We'll go pay for a lawyer opinion. But we won't pick this book up, and it's free. And it's got every revelation about us and every healing power that could take place in a person's life because of Jesus Christ himself. You must trust and know God did not create the storms. God did not create the storms. He allows the storms to happen in our life, but he did not create the storms in our life. But he allows us to go through the storms to be able to find him, to be able to come yield ourselves to the cross and commit ourselves to him and say, I surrender. See, I remember sitting 7 years and being discipled, and God said, sit in the back and be quiet. pick up your book, pull out your pad, and pull out your pen and take notes. And that's what I started doing, being disciples. See, the problem with most of us, we won't get discipled. We're too busy. We're too busy doing nothing. We're too busy doing nothing. Instead of picking up the Word of God and studying the Word and realizing that God has a revelation for us if we pick it up and we spend time with Him. He's pretty cool when you spend time with Him. When you turn off the television, when you turn off the cell phone, and when you go isolate yourself and saturate yourself in the Word of God, God is pretty cool. He speaks to you. See, we can't hear Him because of all the noise and all the other things that are going on in our society. It's so dark and, you know, it's so gloomy, you know, and we can't really hear God when things are happening because we're so focused on the problems instead of the solution, which is Jesus. Jesus is the great solution for every problem that I ever had. He healed me from my addiction. 19 years of recovery, my wife 21 years. He healed me from cancer twice. Lost my left kidney in the second surgery. I only got one kidney. I don't know when God's going to take me home, but baby, I can tell you one thing. I'm going to finish this race strong. I know He's going to take me home one day, but see, I'm ready to go. I'm not going to miss this here. I'm ready now because I know I'm whole in righteousness and right standards with God. And you got to get to that place in your life. You have to ask yourself that question. Am I really in right standards with God? You must trust that God's plan still stands. It does. God's plan still stands. God never changes. Guess who changes? We do. Guess who not obeying? Us. Guess who does not believe? We don't believe. You can see a miracle right in front of you, and you still won't believe it. Because you're looking at one today. You're looking at a miracle from Jesus Himself. Because that's what Jesus does. He's the miracle maker. He always did miracles, and He's still doing miracles today. And some of us be saying, well, where are the miracles? Well, you are the miracle when you wake up every day. See, because tomorrow's not promised to none of us. But when you wake up every day, that's the miracle that Jesus has done. He's allowed you to get up another day to overcome all these earthly things. See, I've overcome everything. People goes, well, don't you like baseball? I goes, like, no. What do I want to like baseball for? I played 17 years. I love Jesus. I love doing kingdom work. I'm leaving here. I'm excited. I'm leaving here. I'm going to be with Dabo Sweeney. He called me the other day, and my manager, and he said, will you come speak to my team? We met Dabo Sweeney and Tony Dungy at an event in Minneapolis, and he heard me speak, and he goes, oh, my God, I got to have you at my program. He goes, my players need this. He goes, the number one, most important thing for my players, he said, is them having a relationship with God, because he said, that's what I stand for. That's what a real coach is about. You know, a real coach is not about, well, you know, yeah, we got to win all the time. Yeah, he wants to win. There's no question about it. But he wants his players to become men. He wants them to grow up with some principles. You know, you respect a coach like that because most of the coaches are not like that. It's all about, you know, what we got to do. You can live any kind of way. He goes, no. He goes, I don't live for that. He says, I don't live that way. He says, I live for Jesus. And he says, my players know it. And he said, they know it coming in, that my faith is my most important thing in my life, is to let them know that my faith is first. That's a man. That's what we've gotten away from in this nation, is our faith being first, no matter who likes us and who don't. You know, and I think a lot of times we're more consumed and concerned about who likes us and who don't like us Doesn't matter who liked me or not. I remember when I started this journey 19 years ago following Jesus, I remember all the guys I was playing with, they was like, yeah, well, let's see how long this will last. They're still waiting. I've gone on about my business. They're still looking, is he gonna come back to baseball? I'm not coming back, there's nothing there. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I can't get to the new if I'm still holding on to the old. God's got something new for you every day, for you and your family. See, me and my family, blessed. We got 9 kids. We got a blended family. Blessed. I mean, the Lord has multiplied us, our ministry. FindingYourWay.com is our ministry. My wife, Tracy, she's an incredible pastor, teacher, leader at the church that we go to. We are blessed. Why? Because we follow the biblical principles. We live by the word of God. Even when things happen, God still takes care of us. Because that is his promises over our life. God promises over our life that he would take care of you. He would never leave you nor forsake you. Everybody else will be gone, but he won't be gone. But do we believe that? Can we come to that place of believing that, even in the midst of a pandemic? Can we believe God is still God? Yeah, we've been tested. But we're lucky. We're so lucky that God didn't allow it to be a famine on the land. Because just think, if he allows a famine on the land, nobody's got nothing. You should read the book. Because there were times back then there were famines on the land. And it could be a famine on the land here. What would you do? Who would you trust? Who would you believe? Do you know him? Do you trust him? Do you worship him? Do you honor him? Do you give him glory? Do you stand for the biblical principles, or do you just stand for what somebody else is saying? I would encourage you and challenge you, pick up the book for yourself. You might find out who you are if you pick the book up. That's the cool thing about the Bible. If you pick the Bible up, the revelation of who you are is going to come, because God's going to reveal himself. And then when he reveals himself, you become a descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now you get to eat from a land you don't even know about. I don't worry about eating from this land, because this land is nothing. God's land is better. See, when you taste and see that the Lord is good, then you understand how rich he really is. You'll understand that he owns all of this. He can stop a heart, he can stop anything he wants at any given time and says, that's it. He can stop you at any given time. I don't care how much you have, I don't care how successful you are, you can be the richest, famous person, you're still gonna die. And guess what? Not a penny going with you. I buried my mother at the age of 55. I buried my sister at the age of 51 from cancer. They went home to be with the Lord. I led my sister to the Lord on her deathbed. I led my whole family to the Lord because God said so. My father, who rejected me and told me I'd never be anything and beat me and wasn't in my life, he was on his deathbed. God sends me down to the hospital to repent to him for keeping him out of my life and my career and not letting him see his grandkid. He says, how dare you not forgive him and I forgave you? He says, who are you? Who do you think you are? I go down and ask him to forgive me, and he said, yes. A tear came out of his eye. I lost it, laid in his lap, just cried. God said, raise up. I raised up. God said, lead him in a center prayer. I said, you know, the Lord has changed my life. Would you like to accept him as Lord over your life? He says, yes. There was the man that rejected me, beating me. I'm leading him in a center prayer. And he goes on and passed away 4 months later. This is the God I'm talking about is good. This is the one that hung on that cross at Calvary for me and for you, that we could have life and have it more abundantly. So this is when things happen. Financial problems, sickness, marital problem. If you got some kids, you're gonna have some problems. Job loss, the reality of what we experience in life. As long as we live, we're gonna experience some things in life, but when I trust in the Lord and believe in my heart with Him, everything's gonna be all right, no matter what it looks like. Because He never fails us. Guess what, we fail Him. He never rejects us. Guess what, we reject Him. Because we're too busy doing nothing and going nowhere. And God is sitting on the throne with Jesus at the right hand, waiting for His people to come back. Come back home. Think about the Israelites. They could have been in the promised land in 11 days and listened to Moses as they saw the miracles. They saw the miracles. Moses parting the Red Sea. They saw the miracles and still didn't believe. And God left them stuck in the wilderness for another 40 years. That's one thing I love about Him. He'll leave you stuck right where you're at. You want to stay there? You can stay there. But see, a lot of the guys I played with, they still stuck in baseball. They still stuck with the uniform. The uniform didn't make me a man. The uniform made me a baseball player. I became a man when I met Jesus. It's a big difference in that. You can hover over your titles and your success and what you have. That won't make you a man. What makes you a man when you come to know Jesus and you walk in these principles and you live according to the biblical principles. That's what makes you a man. That's what a real man, that's what God created us for. He created us to be of His image, His likeness, like Him, to love others, to care for others, to not point fingers at others. So as I close down, in the book of John is about believing. When you read the book of John, I love the whole Bible, but the book of John is bad. Jesus turning water into wine, feeding the 5,000, raising Lazarus from the dead. Jesus is a bad dude. John 3, He told Nicodemus, unless one is born again, he can't enter into the kingdom of heaven. Nicodemus was a Pharisee teacher leader. He was confused. He didn't understand what Jesus was talking about. He was talking about being born of the Spirit. See, I'm born of the Spirit. What you see now is the Spirit of God that dwells in me that preaches the gospel. Man can't give you that. That's the Spirit that's born of God's Spirit, the second birth. John 4, there's no secrets of God. He told the woman at the well about her five husbands. Say, the husband you live with now is not your husband. So there's no secrets. And he's telling that woman, by the way, that water you keep drinking out of that well, you always have a thirst for it. But he said, if you drink this living water, he's telling her, if you drink this living water that I got, you will never thirst again. If you drink this living water that he has, ever since I've been drinking this, I have never, ever, 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 ever been thirsty again. Because it's living water. John 5, we'll go to John 8. John 8, woman caught in adultery. They want to stone her because of the law of Moses. Jesus was just hanging out with the woman, and he kind of just was in the sand and kind of raised up, and he said, he without sin cast the first stone. From the oldest to the youngest dropped their stones and walked away because they all had fallen short. He said, woman, where are your accusers? Has anyone accused you? She says, no. He said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. See, if we can get this and realize that we don't have to live a sinful life, I'm a sinner anymore. It's a big difference. If we can get that, get the whole lot of the for you. John 5, the pool of Bethesda, was a pool where a man sat there with a condition, and he sat there for like 38 years paralyzed. And the angels would stir up the pool, and the first one that would get in the pool was made well immediately. And this man sat there for 38 years. And Jesus saw the man, and Jesus never asked the man about his condition, because Jesus don't have to ask anyone about their condition, because he already knows the condition of every last one of us. Jesus asked that man one thing. He says, do you want to be made well? And the man says, sir, every time I try to get in the pool, he wasn't talking about the excuses. He says, do you want to be made well? And the man said, yes. He says, pick up your bed and walk. Made him well immediately, just like that. This is how good Jesus is. I wish I could give to you what's in me, but I can't because I work for it. I work for it by studying the Word. And he put all the revelation and information about his Word down inside of me. The reason why I know Scripture is because they're in my belly, they're not in my head. Because the Holy Spirit has retained Scriptures for me, because the Holy Spirit taught me the Bible supernaturally. And when he was teaching me the Bible, I said, retain Scriptures for me and put them in my belly. So when I need a Scripture, it's down in my belly, and he'll pull it up and he'll bring it to me. I can see the whole picture of the Scripture. And this is why we're falling short and not having victory. Christians should be living a victorious life. I live a victorious life ever since I started following God's principles. Ever since my wife straightened me out. Guys, that's a good thing that God gave you if that woman straightened you out. Take heed. It'll change your whole life if you just listen. Doesn't make you a less of a man, it makes you a better man. My whole life's changed because I started listening to my wife. God gave her to me because she was a helpmate. We as a society and a generation, we've gotten away from the importance of what that's all about. When things happen, who are you trusting? Ask yourself. That's for someone that's here today. God's tugging at your heart. You need to make some changes. Make them. He's good. He won't lead you the wrong way. Everyone else will, but God will lead you the right way. He'll lead you into the man that he created you to be. And it is really awesome when you can become the man that he created you to be. Let us pray. Father, thank you for your word. Holy Spirit, thank you for what you do. Thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for people. Thank you for penetrating the hearts of the people. And Father, I know that things have been said and people are listening, and there need to be some people make some changes in their life. Decisions today. Tomorrow's never promised to us. We don't know what tomorrow's going to bring us. We know what today is. We're here. May we honor you. May we glorify you. May someone today make a new commitment in their heart to you, that they will surrender their life to you and trust your plan. You have a great plan. I've never seen any plan like this in my life. I've seen a lot of things, done a lot of things, but I've never seen a plan so great and so clear like yours. Bless it today, and we send this petition up to you, and we ask that you seal it over your people. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Amen.
Darryl used a word several times as he spoke with us this morning, a simple word, grace. It's such an amazing summary word of his story, of his life, and it can be the summary story of all of our life. Grace is simply the goodness that God gives us that we don't deserve. None of us deserve it, but God wants to pour it out on our life, forgiveness and blessing, because he's a good and loving God. So we're going to close with this hymn, Grace That Is Greater Than Our Sin. When we come to faith in him, nothing can keep us away from his goodness and blessing if we just simply place our faith in Christ. Stand and sing of his grace as we close this morning.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord,
Thank you so much for worshiping with us this morning. Hope you'll come back for Paul Balash. It's going to be an amazing concert. We would love to have you back. 6:30 for him singing, 7 o'clock. Paul and the Dave Pettigrew Band playing with him tonight. Darryl will be in the lobby here for a little bit of a meet and greet after our service. So thank you so much. God bless. Have a wonderful day.